Leviathan. By Thomas Hobbes. Part 3. Of a Christian Commonwealth. Continues. Chapter XLII. Of Power Ecclesiastical. Continues. Of Ecclesiastical Revenue, under the Law of Moses. Under the Old Testament, the tribe of Levi were only capable of the priesthood, and other inferior offices of the church. The land was divided amongst the other tribes, Levi excepted, which by the subdivision of the tribe of Joseph, into Ephraim and Manasseh, were still 12. To the tribe of Levi were assigned certain cities for their habitation, with the suburbs for their cattle, but for their portion, they were to have the tenth of the fruits of the land of their brethren. Again, the priests for their maintenance had the tenth of that tenth, together with part of the oblations, and sacrifices. For God had said to Aaron, Num 18. 20, Thou shalt have no inheritance in their land, neither shalt thou have any part amongst them, I am thy part, and thine inheritance amongst the children of Israel. For God being then king, and having constituted the tribe of Levi to be his public ministers, he allowed them for their maintenance, the public revenue, that is to say, the part that God had reserved to himself, which were tithes, and offerings, and that it is which is meant, where God saith, I am thine inheritance. And therefore to the Levites might not unfitly be attributed the name of clergy from Kilros, which signifieth lot, or inheritance, not that they were heirs of the kingdom of God, more than other, but that God's inheritance, was their maintenance. Now seeing in this time God himself was their king, and Moses, Aaron, and the succeeding high priests were his lieutenants, it is manifest, that the right of tithes, and offerings was constituted by the civil power. After their rejection of God in the demand of a king, they enjoyed still the same revenue, but the right thereof was derived from that the kings did never take it from them, for the public revenue was at the disposing of him that was the public person, and that, till the captivity, was the king. And again, after the return from the captivity, they paid their tithes as before to the priest. Hitherto therefore church livings were determined by the civil sovereign. In our Savior's time, and after. Of the maintenance of our Savior, and his apostles, we read only they had a purse, which was carried by Judas Iscariot and, that of the apostles, such as were fishermen, did sometimes use their trade, and that when our Savior sent the 12 apostles to preach, he forbade them to carry gold and silver and brass in their purses, for that the workman is worthy of his hire, Matt 10:9-10. By which it is probable, their ordinary maintenance was not unsuitable to their employment, for their employment was, Verse 8, freely to give, because they had freely received, and their maintenance was the free gift of those that believed the good tidding they carried about of the coming of the Messiah their Savior. To which we may add, that which was contributed out of gratitude, by such as our Savior had healed of diseases, of which are mentioned certain women, Luke 8:2-3, which had been healed of evil spirits and infirmities, Mary Magdalene, out of whom went seven devils, and Joanna the wife of Chuza, Herod's steward, and Susanna, and many others, which many spread unto him of their substance. After our Savior's ascension, the Christians of every city lived in common, Acts 4:34, upon the money which was made of the sale of their lands and possessions, and laid down at the feet of the apostles, of good will, not of duty, for whilst the land remained, saith S. Peter to Ananias Acts 5:4. Was it not thine? And after it was sold, was it not in thy power? Which shewth he needed not to have saved his land, nor his money by lying, as not being bound to contribute anything at all, unless he had pleased. And as in the time of the apostles, so also all the time downward, till after Constantine the Great, we shall find, that the maintenance of the bishops, and pastors of the Christian Church, was nothing but the voluntary contribution of them that had embraced their doctrine. There was yet no mention of tithes, but such was in the time of Constantine, and his sons, the affection of Christians to their pastors, as Ammianus Marcellinus saith, describing the sedition of Damasus and Ursinicus about the bishopric, that it was worth their contention, in that the bishops of those times, by the liberality of their flock, and especially of matrons, lived splendidly, were carried in coaches, and sumptuous in their fare and apparel. The ministers of the gospel lived on the benevolence of their flocks, but here may some ask, whether the pastor were then bound to live upon voluntary contribution, as upon alms, for who, saith S. Paul 1 Cor 9, 7, goeth to war at his own charges? Or who feedeth a flock, and eateth not of the milk of the flock? And again, 1 Cor 9, 13, do ye not know that they which minister about holy things, live of the things of the temple, and they which wait at the altar, partake with the altar, that is to say, have part of that which is offered at the altar for their maintenance? And then he concludeth, even so hath the Lord appointed, that they which preach the gospel should live of the gospel. From which place may be inferred indeed, that the pastors of the church ought to be maintained by their flocks, but not that the pastors were to determine, either the quantity, or the kind of their own allowance, and be, as it were, their own carvers. Their allowance must needs therefore be determined, either by the gratitude, and liberality of every particular man of their flock, or by the whole congregation. By the whole congregation it could not be, because their acts were then no laws, therefore the maintenance of pastors, before emperors and civil sovereigns had made laws to settle it, was nothing but benevolence. They that served at the altar lived on what was offered. In what court should they sue for it, who had no tribunals? Or if they had arbitrators amongst themselves, who should execute their judgments, when they had no power to arm their officers? It remaineth therefore, that there could be no certain maintenance assigned to any pastors of the church, but by the whole congregation, and then only, when their decrees should have the force, not only of canons, but also, of laws, which laws could not be made, but by emperors, kings, or other civil sovereigns. The right of tithes in Moses' law could not be applied to the then ministers of the gospel, because Moses and the high priests were the civil sovereigns of the people under God, whose kingdom amongst the Jews was present, whereas the kingdom of God by Christ is yet to come. Hitherto hath been shown what the pastors of the church are, what are the points of their commission, as that they were to preach, to teach, to baptize, to be presidents in their several congregations what is ecclesiastical censure, viz. Excommunication, that is to say, in those places where Christianity was forbidden by the civil laws, a putting of themselves out of the company of the excommunicate, and where Christianity was by the civil law commanded, a putting the excommunicate out of the congregations of Christians, who elected the pastors and ministers of the church, that it was the congregation who consecrated and blessed them, that it was the pastor, what was their due revenue, that it was none but their own possessions, and their own labor, and the voluntary contributions of devout and grateful Christians. We are to consider now, what office those persons have, who being civil sovereigns, have embraced also the Christian faith. The civil sovereign being a Christian hath the right of appointing pastors. And first, we are to remember, that the right of judging what doctrines are fit for peace, and to be taught the subjects, is in all commonwealths inseparably annexed, as hath been already proved chap. 18, to the sovereign power civil, whether it be in one man, or in one assembly of men. For it is evident to the meanest capacity, that men's actions are derived from the opinions they have of the good, or evil, which from those actions redound unto themselves, and consequently, men that are once possessed of an opinion, that their obedience to the sovereign power, will be more hurtful to them, than their disobedience, will disobey the laws, and thereby overthrow the commonwealth, and introduce confusion, and civil war, for the avoiding whereof, all civil government was ordained. And therefore in all commonwealths of the heathen, the sovereigns have had the name of pastors of the people, because there was no subject that could lawfully teach the people, but by their permission and authority. This right of the heathen kings, cannot be thought taken from them by their conversion to the faith of Christ, who never ordained, that kings for believing in him, should be deposed, that is, subjected to any but himself, or, which is all one, be deprived of the power necessary for the conservation of peace amongst their subjects, and for their defense against foreign enemies. And therefore Christian kings are still the supreme pastors of their people, and have power to ordain what pastors they please, to teach the church, that is, to teach the people committed to their charge. Again, let the right of choosing them be, as before the conversion of kings, in the church, for so it was in the time of the apostles themselves, as hath been shown already in this chapter, even so also the right will be in the civil sovereign, Christian. For in that he is a Christian, he allows the teaching, and in that he is the sovereign, which is as much as to say, the church by representation, the teachers he elects, are elected by the church. And when an assembly of Christians choose their pastor in a Christian commonwealth, it is the sovereign that electeth him, because 'tis done by his authority, in the same manner, as when a town choose their mayor, it is the act of him that hath the sovereign power, for every act done, is the act of him, without whose consent it is invalid. And therefore whatsoever examples may be drawn out of history, concerning the election of pastors, by the people, or by the clergy, they are no arguments against the right of any civil sovereign, because they that elected them did it by his authority. Seeing then in every Christian commonwealth, the civil sovereign is the supreme pastor, to whose charge the whole flock of his subjects is committed, and consequently that it is by his authority, that all other pastors are made, and have power to teach, and perform all other pastoral offices, it followeth also, that it is from the civil sovereign, that all other pastors derive their right of teaching, preaching, and other functions pertaining to that office, and that they are but his ministers, in the same manner as the magistrates of towns, judges in courts of justice, and commanders of armies, are all but ministers of him that is the magistrate of the whole commonwealth, judge of all causes, and commander of the whole militia, which is always the civil sovereign. And the reason hereof, is not because they that teach, but because they that are to learn, are his subjects. For let it be supposed, that a Christian king commit the authority of ordaining pastors in his dominions to another king, as divers Christian kings allow that power to the Pope, he doth not thereby constitute a pastor over himself, nor a sovereign pastor over his people, for that were to deprive himself of the civil power, which depending on the opinion men have of their duty to him, and the fear they have of punishment in another world, would depend also on the skill, and loyalty of doctors, who are no less subject, not only to ambition, but also to ignorance, than any other sort of men. So that where a stranger hath authority to appoint teachers, it is given him by the sovereign in whose dominions he tak hate. Christian doctors are our schoolmasters to Christianity, but kings are fathers of families, and may receive schoolmasters for their subjects from the recommendation of a stranger, but not from the command, especially when the ill teaching them shall redound to the great and manifest profit of him that recommends them, nor can they be obliged to retain them, longer than it is for the public good, the care of which they stand so long charged with L, as they retain any other essential right of the sovereignty. The pastoral authority of sovereigns only is de jure divino, that of other pastors is jure civili. If a man therefore should ask a pastor, in the execution of his office, as the chief priests and elders of the people, Matt. 21.23, asked our Savior, by what authority dost thou these things, and who gave thee this authority, he can make no other just answer, but that he doth it by the authority of the commonwealth, given him by the king, or assembly that representeth it. All pastors, except the supreme, execute their charges in the right, that is by the authority of the civil sovereign, that is, jure civili. But the king, and every other sovereign executeth his office of supreme pastor, by immediate authority from God, that is to say, in God's right, or jure divino. And therefore none but kings can put into their titles, a mark of their submission to God only, Dei gratia rex, NC. Bishops ought to say in the beginning of their mandates, by the favor of the King's Majesty, Bishop of such a diocese, or as civil ministers, in His Majesty's name. For in saying, Divina Providentia, which is the same with Dei gratia, though disguised, they deny to have received their authority from the civil state, and slyly slip off the collar of their civil subjection, contrary to the unity and defense of the Commonwealth. Christian kings have power to execute all manner of pastoral function. But if every Christian sovereign be the supreme pastor of his own subjects, it seemeth that he hath also the authority, not only to preach, which perhaps no man will deny, but also to baptize, and to administer the sacrament of the Lord's Supper, and to consecrate both temples, and pastors to God's service, which most men deny, partly because they use not to do it, and partly because the administration of sacraments, and consecration of persons, and places to holy uses, requireth the imposition of such men's hands, as by the like imposition successively from the time of the apostles have been ordained to the like ministry. For proof therefore that Christian kings have power to baptize, and to consecrate, I am to render a reason, both why they use not to do it, and how, without the ordinary ceremony of imposition of hands, they are made capable of doing it, when they will. There is no doubt but any king, in case he were skillful in the sciences, might by the same right of his office, read lectures of them himself, by which he authorizeth others to read them in the universities. Nevertheless, because the care of the summy of the business of the Commonwealth taketh up his whole time, it were not convenient for him to apply himself in person to that particular. A king may also, if he please, sit in judgment, to hear and determine all manner of causes, as well as give others authority to do it in his name, but that the charge that lieth upon him of command and government, constrain him to be continually at the helm, and to commit the ministerial offices to others under him. In the like manner our Savior, who surely had power to baptize, baptized none himself, but sent his apostles and disciples to baptize. John 4.2. So also S. Paul, by the necessity of preaching in divers and far distant places, baptized few. Amongst all the Corinthians he baptized only Crispus, Cajus, and Stephanus, 1 Cor 1.14-16, and the reason was, because his principal charge was to preach. 1 Cor 1.17. Whereby it is manifest, that the greater charge, such as is the government of the church, is a dispensation for the less. The reason therefore why Christian kings use not to baptize, is evident, and the same, for which at this day there are few baptized by bishops, and by the Pope fewer. And as concerning imposition of hands, whether it be needful, for the authorizing of a king to baptize, and consecrate, we may consider thus. Imposition of hands, was a most ancient public ceremony amongst the Jews, by which was designed, and made certain, the person, or other thing intended in a man's prayer, blessing, sacrifice, consecration, condemnation, or other speech. So Jacob in blessing the children of Joseph, General 48.14, laid his right hand on Ephraim the younger, and his left hand on Manasseh the firstborn, and this he did wittingly, though they were so presented to him by Joseph, as he was forced in doing it to stretch out his arms across, to design to whom he intended the greater blessing. So also in the sacrificing of the burnt offering, Aaron is commanded, Exodus 29.10, to lay his hands on the head of the bullock, and, verse 15, to lay his hand on the head of the ram. The same is also said again, Leviticus 1.4 and 8.14. Likewise Moses when he ordained Joshua to be captain of the Israelites, that is, consecrated him to God's service, Num 27.23. Laid his hands upon him, and gave him his charge, designing and rendering certain, who it was they were to obey in war. And in the consecration of the Levites, Num 8.10. God commanded that the children of Israel should put their hands upon the Levites. And in the condemnation of him that had blasphemed the Lord, Leviticus 24.14. God commanded that all that heard him should lay their hands on his head, and that all the congregation should stone him. And why should they only that heard him, lay their hands upon him, and not rather a priest, Levite, or other minister of justice, but that none else were able to design, and demonstrate to the eyes of the congregation, who it was that had blasphemed, and ought to die. And to design a man, or any other thing, by the hand to the eye is less subject to mistake, than when it is done to the ear by a name. And so much was the ceremony observed, that in blessing the whole congregation at once, which cannot be done by laying on of hands, yet Aaron, Leviticus 9.22, did lift up his hand towards the people when he blessed them. And we read also of the like ceremony of consecration of temples amongst the heathen, as that the priest laid his hands on some post of the temple, all the while he was uttering the words of consecration. So natural it is to design any individual thing, rather by the hand, to assure the eyes, than by words to inform the ear in matters of God's public service. This ceremony was not therefore new in our Savior's time. For Jairus, Mark 5.23, whose daughter was sick, besought our Savior, not to heal her, but, to lay his hands upon her, that she might be healed. And, Matthew 19.13, they brought unto him little children, that he should put his hands on them, and pray. According to this ancient rite, the apostles and presbyters, and the presbytery itself, laid hands on them whom they ordained pastors, and withal prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Ghost, and that not only once, but sometimes oftener, when a new occasion was presented, but the end was still the same, namely a punctual and religious designation of the person, ordained either to the pastoral charge in general, or to a particular mission. So, Act 6.6, the apostles prayed, and laid their hands on the seven deacons, which was done, not to give them the Holy Ghost, for they were full of the Holy Ghost before they were chosen, as appeareth immediately before, verse 3, but to design them to that office. And after Philip the deacon had converted certain persons in Samaria, Peter and John went down, Act 8.17, and laid their hands on them, and they received the Holy Ghost. And not only an apostle, but a presbyter had this power, for S. Paul adviseth Timothy, 1 Tim 5.22. Lay hands suddenly on no man, that is, design no man rashly to the office of a pastor. The whole presbytery laid their hands on Timothy, as we read 1 Tim 4.14. But this is to be understood, as that some did it by the appointment of the presbytery, and most likely their proestos, or prolocutor, which it may be was St. Paul himself. For in his 2 epistle to Tim ver. 6 he saith to him, stir up the gift of God which is in thee, by the laying on of my hands, where note by the way, that by the Holy Ghost, is not meant the third person in the Trinity, but the gifts necessary to the pastoral office. We read also, that St. Paul had imposition of hands twice, once from Ananias at Damascus, Acts 9.17-18, at the time of his baptisma, and again, Acts 13.3, at Antioch, when he was first sent out to preach. The use then of the ceremony considered in the ordination of pastors, was to design the person to whom they gave such power. But if there had been then any Christian, that had had the power of teaching before, the baptizing of him, that is the making of him a Christian, had given him no new power, but had only caused him to preach true doctrine, that is, to use his power aright, and therefore the imposition of hands had been unnecessary, baptism itself had been sufficient. But every sovereign, before Christianity, had the power of teaching, and ordaining teachers, and therefore Christianity gave them no new right, but only directed them in the way of teaching truth, and consequently they needed no imposition of hands, besides that which is done in baptisma, to authorize them to exercise any part of the pastoral function, as namely, to baptize, and consecrate. And in the Old Testament, though the priest only had right to consecrate, during the time that the sovereignty was in the high priest, yet it was not so when the sovereignty was in the king, for we read, 1 Kings 8, that Solomon blessed the people, consecrated the temple, and pronounced that public prayer, which is the pattern now for consecration of all Christian churches, and chapels, whereby it appears, he had not only the right of ecclesiastical government, but also of exercising ecclesiastical functions.